Today, this year's report of Netto Progress Report has an outlook with decentralized censorship. So my motivation for Netto is again that the internet is bad gateway, it's not working, and this year I'm looking on disinformation. For the people who haven't seen what Netto is in a nutshell, Netto is a complete stack of an alternative implementation of an internet style network. It runs on top of the existing internet. So you have path switched packets on the bottom as routing. You have a bunch of crypto stuff on the next layer. You need to do the crypto right on top of the routing. You have control flow and congestion control that is timing driven. You have a stack-oriented tokenized command language to let the nodes talk with each others with metadata, and of course you have distributed data, files and messages, and distributed metadata like DHT and EVCS. And on the top is apps in a sandboxed environment for displaying content. And so far, implementation is progressing quite fine. What did happen in the censorship thing in the last pandemic's part? No longer after Snowden, this time counting after the pandemics. Apple wants to scan your pics locally for child porn, which many people think is a breach of privacy, what they are doing, because they just have their algorithms to scan for pics, and you don't know if there are false positives, and then the police comes and looks for you. So they had to back down that quickly, and they say we will do it later, which means they just wait for the next round of people waiting for the iPhone number 15 or 16 or whatever it is, and then they will introduce it in the back. Facebook and Twitter now tell us they check for facts and still spread a lot of disinformation, a lot. But the tool of choice for the disinformation has become Telegram, which announced it itself as secure communication means, but actually the public groups they have is no more secure than anybody else. They just don't censor as much as Facebook and Twitter. And free speech turned to be out to be more a problem than a solution. And Twitter tries safe spaces for probably the people who have twisted worldviews and want to hide the reality, because that's how Twitter is at the moment kill filing people. It's not killing the disinformation people, but the people who want to set things right by scientific standards. What did I progress from what I wanted to do last year? Not as much as I wanted, because Emil arrived, so it's not less on Net2O, more on Bernd2O. And there's something to celebrate. TCP/IP turns 40 this year. So it's really old. 40 in a computer environment is really old. And IPv6 is already over 20 and still not getting through. So this is a slide from last year. What's this information and what kind of mechanisms create this information? And it turns out that there's no intelligent life on this planet, because a lot of this information comes through first impression. When you look at a topic first time, you have a very strong impression of what you see. And if it's wrong, it's very difficult to fix you. And then there's the IKEA effect, that is easy to obtain things have no value. We probably have this in force as well, because a lot of people build their own force system, which is precisely the IKEA effect, and then think it has a lot of value. Then we have worldviews,
I don't know what
things what we believe, and they let us dismiss facts that don't fit into this. So science needs to be prudent, because science also is often wrong on the first approach, and then it creates the first impression, and when it's wrong there, the wrongness will stick. So science needs to go into the lab and figure out that what is going on really happens, and that they are really sure about things. And maybe it takes a week or 3 weeks or so to figure out everything, and then you can have a press conference and tell the people what's going on. And then there's the plausibility thing. If you think of Bill Gates, you have seen him in Albuquerque speeding with his father's 9/11. So this man is really evil. And he did a lot of other evil things later, like writing basic interpreters, or having a monopoly of Windows. And so you can judge when he is in medicine, he just wants to sell you some basic interpreter and chip you. But that is first impression. His first impression was speeding with his father's 9/11 and selling basic interpreters. So maybe it's not so evil as we think, yes. And there's a joke, a Chinese name joke about QAnon, where we don't really know where they come from, and their origin is supposed to be Wu-Ming, five names, and funny enough, you can pronounce that as ignorance. Wu is Wu-Wei, Wu, so don't do anything, and Ming is brightness. So if you are not bright, you're ignorant. And that is QAnon is one of the bigger disinformation sources. So in this also slide from last time, this is an antisocial hate works. Why do this kind of networks turn into these hate works? And it's the same things with opinions, beliefs, identity, and walls in the head that create that separate people instead of bringing them together. If you think about it, and Douglas Adams, for example, wrote that the baby fish created more wars than any other technology, because people could understand each other and then figure out that they had probably different opinions and beliefs and were clashing. And the same is going on in the internet. And you thought, now people can communicate with each other. What would they create? They would, they create their own safe spaces, their identities, their walls between the identities of the other people. And why do these networks want to create this sort of bad feelings? Is because they want to keep you in their network. And this is here with XKCD. Are you coming to bed? I can't. This is important. What? Someone is wrong on the internet. So of course you find someone who is wrong on the internet, and you have now to argue with him forever. And it's keeping people awake and people active on these social platforms, and these social platforms sell you adverts. So the longer you stay active, the more they earn, and that's, they will tune their filters to gear it towards that. The adverts are the most nicest thing you see there. And what about free speech? Speech, that was the idea, is from the 18th century, and it is too generic, because what they wanted back then was to discuss things in a scientific or more scientific manner as the Catholic Church before, and to find truth by discussion and sharing opinions, and not to share lies and deception. And so you need to implement some sort of scientific process that it's going to work. So a claim needs evidence, truth needs protection, and lies and deception doesn't need protection. And they can figure out what is truth and what is lie and deception by scientific method, by experiment. So what did I do? So go back. I had this things to be done, who has what last year, because when you share things in a peer-to-peer network, you need to know who has what, and you actually don't want it to be in the DHT, because that is
what is a DHT?
A dynamic hash table, a distributed hash table, So you have, everybody knows a bit about the objects, and you ask the people who know or the machines who know. And by asking so, the machines know what you want. And that is complex to solve in a privacy way. And here, my solution is that you put the who has what within the chat log structure and just distribute it with the chat log. So the people who talk to each other anyhow and share things tell you they know who has what. And this is far less problematic than the DHT. And what my implementation is still missing is a limit of reach of who has what, because if you have a very large chat, you don't want to have a who has what from every part of this chat. If you say you have 1 million people sharing Justin Bieber's feed and they all share this photos, you don't want to have your chat log clobbered with 1 million I have this photo entries. So you want to have some locality on this. So a limit of reach is maybe it lives for 3 hops and then it disappears. Then you have enough people who have this object to get it, but not too many to be overloaded by the amount of data. That's also in progress is Halfbus. Halfbus is a rendering engine for a more complex part of the Unicode things. If you think about Indian scripts or Arabic scripts, or if you're a Tolkien fan, if you think about Tengwa, which is very obviously has a lot of Indian and Arabic parts in it. So this is you have to deal with ticks on the top and the bottom, diacritic marks on many characters, and you have they flow into each other, and it's not so easy, and there's a lot of code done by the people who did Halfbus. They are not fully completed with what they wanted to reach, and Unicode is growing, but it's important, and it's even important for emojis, because if you have these colored emojis or emojis with gender, then you have modifiers, and modifiers are part of this more complicated Unicode rendering. And I must say, Unicode uses infix or postfix, and I actually don't like either, because in a postfix means you need to scan past the current character to figure out what is going to be done with that character. For example, if you have a modifier, a variant modifier of a character, you need to look beyond the character, because the variant modifier is behind it. So it's not something you can process straight on and have a state machine and then kick the parts wherever you need them. That is what I would have done. A text processing needs to go one character at a time and make a decision, a local decision at each character when it's a meta character, not printable characters, and needs to make a decision and go further. But Unicode isn't like that. So you have to really look ahead and figure out, oh, this is a variant. So this the character before is actually an icon, needs to go to the icon font and render there. And maybe there is another combiner following it, and then there's another character. And maybe this one has a modifier, a variant modifier as well, because it's a normal character, but it should be rendered as icon. And it's part of these things you have to do yourself, even when you do half pass, but a lot of things half pass takes from you. The interface is good. You just have buffers and you write into the buffers and it tells them what kind of font you use. And then it outputs the rendered glyphs, and then you have display them. It requires restructuring my code, because at the moment my code was this one character, one decision, and I can't do this anymore. And I have to think about right to left scripts, or maybe up to down, top to bottom scripts, and have objects that can be formatted in the other way round, right to left. So the challenge here is the combiners select the text by font, and you need to figure out all the combiners and how the variant modifiers choose a different font and then feed it to half-pass, and then it should be mostly done. What I've done is formatting with chat messages that is inspired by MetaMost, so you can pass different markdown. Passing is a bit different from markdown, simpler, but maybe I just take my markdown parser and have just one parser in the system. It's disabled by default because people got confused with the formatting options. Now you now have characters which mean something different and you cannot just type them right ahead. And when you talk about force, you usually use all characters in the ASCII set. So disabled by default is okay. The sender parses, so the sender can change the parser without the actual formatting already sent changing. So you can have markdown instead of the simpler parser, and it doesn't change anything normally. When you send things, it's pre-passed. So when you change the markup or language, then everything changes and you cannot do that later. And I want to be able to change things here. Maybe have the users also change things and they say, oh, I want markdown or I want a different option. What I've mostly done was voice messages. That is part of the experience of video conferences. And in Linux, recording and send playback is done with Pulse Audio, and that works fine. Encoding is with Opus. That gives very good quality and compact file. On Android, I still have problems with OpenSlash recording. That is likely due to problems with the callbacks into GeForce Dynamic Code. Android used to do this, but it doesn't do it anymore. And the rest of how you share voice messages is similar to pictures. You just put in an object into the chat, but you need a different thumbnail. The thumbnail needs to be a waveform plot with the maximum level 1 per second. And you see, this looks like a voice message and actually has some relationship to what you are doing. So, go to the future, the decentralized censorship, and the ideas make Netto a better place, or well, it's a good place at the moment because three people are chatting on Netto regularly and say there's no need for censorship at the moment, but this will change when it's bigger. And it's not external censorship, so it doesn't mean some state entity censors your thoughts. It's internal. It's the group chatting with each other doesn't want to be too much disrupted by people who are inside and pollute the information space. And the funny thing is that if you look at the pandemics, this infodemic in a peer-to-peer network distributes just like a virus. It's spreading out from one node to several and from there to more. So what you do filter is not your own stuff. It's filtering incoming content. And that is different from what Apple wants to do with you. Filtering incoming content is what you are much more likely okay with, because you want the annoying content to be out. You have that problem with the spam, and you are very happy to have some anti-spam measures in email. Like anti-spam measures, the sender does not know that the content is blocked, it just disappears. So the sender does not try to repeat differently and try to figure out a way around the filtering, because the sender is not aware of the filtering. So you have different possibilities how to filter. You can just hide the message you see and transmit the messages to others. You can just transmit the stop transmitting the messages, but still see them. For example, if you want to judge what kind of person this is after you have seen the awful messages and you don't want to contribute to the mess in the network, but you still want to see. Or you have both, and that is in pandemic vocabulary, is a sterile immunity. So you filter what's incoming and you don't transmit anything. You don't get the disinfodemic and you don't transmit the disinfodemic. When you have a fan out in your peer-to-peer network, which equals R0, then you have the formulas of very easy epidemiological models for virus. So if more than one by minus one by R0 filter, the bad content is blocked effectively. It's not going far. If less filter, then it goes further. What it requires is easy filter sharing. That is what we don't have in real life in pandemics, is vaccination. Filter sharing is some sort of vaccination, and we can do it much better in the computer world than in the real world. It still has a side effect that it blocks things maybe you don't want to have blocked, but it's very easy to share and it doesn't get fever and things like that. So here are some examples of disinfodemics in the COVID pandemic. That is Dr. Li Wenliang was gag ordered by the Wuhan police when the menus, Xin Wenlianbo, already had a report about the outbreak. So people here said this wouldn't happen here in the Free West. So yeah, a whole lot of disinformation spread out right from the White House and other places in the West. So yeah, we didn't block the people who said stupid nonsense, and it was a lot worse than this one doctor got gag ordered by a stupid policeman while they were already working at the disease and had reports to the WHO and whatever, and figured out what the DNA, the RNA A from the virus is, and so on. Then people have the concept of an evil government, and they are mostly right, but the government is also incompetent, which is also, today is 9/11, so I should tell you, if you think George W. Bush and Dick Cheney managed this kind of attack, they didn't even find the weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. So they are incompetent. They wouldn't have managed that. It's not plausible. They are evil, but they are not competent enough to do such a thing. And its bias is pro-cooperation, so their evilness serves a purpose, and you know that purpose, and figure out what did they do with the pandemic. Is it pro-cooperation? It hurts a lot of cooperation, so it's a stupid idea, this pandemic, too, as evil government. Science? Yeah, science does question everything, but it conducts experiments to check. So it did conduct experiments on masks, and they worked. It did conduct experiments on lockdowns. Actually, they worked since 3,000 years. The oldest lockdown reports we have is still from old Babylonia, maybe 4,000 years old, and they work. If you reduce R0 by have no longer contacts with the ill people, it works. The Wuhan lab didn't leak. We have no evidence for that, but we have a lot of counter evidence from the structure of the virus, which makes it very unplausible that it came out of a lab. The vaccines are safe, which is safe is of course a function of how often they have bad side effects, because there's nothing 100% safe. But it's a risk. It's related to the infection itself. And all this miracle cure of the day, maybe you give ivermectin to your horse and chloroquine to a malaria person. And vitamin D is quite good in winter, but it's not a miracle cure. And what I think is what happens here in the West is a massacre. And actually, yesterday, the French police started investigating in one of the culprits not doing lockdowns fast enough in the first wave. So their health minister is now under investigation. And we are a democracy, so how can we do massacres? Only with massive disinformation. So what can you do to cure these things? Manual moderation is always easy, and it's always too late and too little. You can delete bad content, you can leave the corrections, you can block the bad actors. In a P2P network, people can, of course, block the moderators, and so you need a rough consensus, and it's not the people who say, I think the moderator is the evil actor, when they are the majority, the moderator doesn't get through. Managerial interaction is also too slow, and people don't read rectifications. So if you say headline is in Kansas, the ivermectin poisoned people fill the ICUs and the gun-wounded people can't get a place in the hospital. Yes, it was actually wrong, but the people read the headline and they go on and they believe that is the headline, and I believe that. Oh, in Oklahoma, it was in Oklahoma. It was just a teaser which didn't have much truth in it. So go automatic filter, and that is harder. So you can have bad texts, filter text, bad text, and that's in pandemic, it's equals to a PCR test. You look for the text, you check if it has patterns of known evilness, This is easy to implement and easy to defeat, and also easy to be false positive. For example, in the beginning of the pandemics, I tried to explain somebody on Facebook why there's no vaccine for MERS, because MERS is for camellias. It's a disease that affects camellias. And of course, the German word for camellia is also a derogative word for Arabians in altogether. So bang, Facebook decided if you say camellia in German, you get kicked out immediately. And there's no way to say different. And MERS is a disease carried by camels, and it spreads from camels to humans, so to camellias normally, because they are very close in contact with camels, but not much further. So actually, it's not Arabs, it's just the camellias themselves. And the job is good, and it's nothing to worry about this. There's no other word in German for this. So, and images, and they have these fingerprints like what Apple tries to use, and it's not really difficult to implement, maybe a bit more difficult than text. And it's also easy to defeat if you know the algorithm. And you can create pre-image attacks because these fingerprints are not secure hashes. So you can create whatever picture you like, and it fingerprints like any other picture you want. But this is defeating the smart people. The smart people can defeat it, and they are usually not so much the problem. Audio is speech to text. We have enough knowledge how to do that now. And the defeat is unclear. And it's probably also easy to generate pre-image attacks because this speech to text is not perfect and you can confuse it. So what kind of bad text would I filter? It's actually not bad words like what Facebook does. When you look at the Facebook group spreading the disinformation, the spelling is really awful. They are shouting all the time and they have colorful exclamation marks in high number. So it's really relatively easy to see what they are up to. For smart people, it should be very easy to defeat because you just spell check what you write, you don't shout all the time, and you don't put too many exclamation marks. But they don't seem to be the problem in this disinfodemic. And of course, people try to filter porn with AI, and that picture on the right, that dunes have enough curves and skin tones that they got filtered out as porn. So this is landscape porn. And here's some fun, because that's how filter algorithms work in real life. And I used cartoons from a recently deceased cartoonist, which is very famous in German and has done over 4,000 cartoons. And you find whatever you need, you find at least 10 cartoons from him. And these are just two. Now here, the holy algorithms of Facebook's never are wrong. So you are blocked, and he is now blocked 30 days at Facebook because he made the flat earthler angry. He posted something about the globe on the flat earth news group, and now he's blocked. And that's very typical for the way filtering works. When you think about a majority defines what's right, and the majority in the group of flat earthers is of course not the people who believe in a globe. So mostly done. Now some non-technical problem as usual, and What I actually need to get ready is an app with Net2O that people can just install on their mobile phone or on Linux. And Microsoft made something nice for me. Windows 11 has WSLG, which means you can have graphic Linux programs running on Windows. And I don't have to do a lot of work to port this thing to Windows. Just get Windows 11 and wait half a year and it's working stable also. So that's the literature. I can post these links later on MetaMost, and you can come up with questions.
Thank you very much, Bernd. If you have any questions on the Twitch chat, please put them in now. Are there any questions in Big Blue Button? Then please raise your hand. Peter next, please go ahead.
Helps if I bring the microphone down. You are aware that Apple withdrew.
Is my microphone broken? My earphone broken?
We can hear you.
The microphone's fine, the earphones aren't.
Yes, so Peter was just talking. Can you hear us now back again, Bernd? Can you hear us? We are talking to you, Bernd. You are permitted to go to speaker if you like, as you are the speaker. This is probably the worst.
Okay.
Okay. Peter, please go ahead.
Now I can hear you.
Good. Peter, okay. Please go ahead.
As a demonstration that people don't read retractions, you are aware that Apple withdrew the statement that they will be adding software to everyone's phone about a fortnight after it hit the press.
No, they were not saying they withdrew it. They were saying they were doing it later.
Mm.
That is true, yes.
Are there further comments or questions to Bernd? Anton?
Yeah, there's one. It's a bit hard you're right. In a lot of cases, it's easy to tell whether somebody is doing some nonsense by using maybe colored question. Clearing up nonsense. Mm-hmm. And of course, I don't know. Basically, it's one thing I see there is that they have all these. So one section of that site is on nuclear power, and basically all these crackpot nuclear power things like molten salt reactors and so on, that basically not even the nuclear industry believes in, are there in force. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are difficult things, and this cannot be automated, and this is difficult to do manually. Because you see, if you look at these sites, they do a lot of work to figure out if that is actually feasible or not, and it's not so easy. So this is not for the long run, it works. It's just like any manual correction, it takes too long. So social networks are fast, and when you say, but we have this molten salt reactor and it's working, and then 5 weeks later someone explains why it's not working, then it's 5 weeks too late.
Well, yeah, it's not a social media site. It's more like Wikipedia or something. But
Zenith can do it. That's a good idea.
Yeah, but the problem is, I mean, of course, you would now need, I mean, they have established themselves on that site. Mm-hmm. So how do you convince the larger community of that site that these particular people are wrong? And do you really want to invest a lot of your life into doing that?
That is a drag you on the social network. Just in this thing, leave these groups alone and make sure they don't contaminate too many others with their nonsense.
Okay, are there further questions?
You will usually only have a chance to immunize people who have not first contact with this kind of thing.
Take CLF as an example.
Well, you can take any group as an example.
This is everywhere.
Everywhere. The question is, there will be people with sources of bad information everywhere. Mm-hmm. The question is, how do you trade off? And this is a conundrum, how you trade off speech rights versus blocking bad information.
Yeah, and you have to say that bad information really can be very harmful, so speech right is not superseding everything.
Right, but that's more of a political discussion, I'm afraid. Is there any more technical questions? I mean, I'm not stopping the discussion now. I'm sorry, I just wanted to close out the Twitch chat and become offline. That's what I'm trying to do here. But are there any more questions from you which are technical, which might be interesting as well? I think, Bob, you tried to say something before.
I just was saying that very much enjoyed this. I think one of our great battles now is the battle for equality between the ordinary citizen and the government employee, and the whole notion that governments and now these massive social media can dictate these what's true and what's not. Run into all the time the fact that they're far more ignorant than an awful lot of the people that I'm communicating with. I see a future in people having individual sovereign web spaces and if you will, some aggregating sort of a system that sort of maybe gets back to some earlier structures. But disassembling these centralized social media groups.
Yeah, that is one point of Net2O, disassembling this. As you said, the centralized censorship in Facebook and Twitter does not work. And when they want to have something on there, it's often they have conflicts of interest. It's just not only the government. Facebook has conflicts of interest. They want to keep these flat earthers.
Yeah, sure. It's a very...
Facebook is amazingly stupid. They banned a picture of a thistle blossom that I posted to a friend. It's unbelievable, and just the stupidity. I mean, again, in the climate groups that I engage in, the people they've spent their lives in the subject, and Facebook deigns to claim to have a better understanding. And the same thing, of course, with COVID.
Okay, well, sure. Guys, it's getting a bit political and it's a fair discussion, but not for Twitch, I'm afraid. So I would like to thank Bernd for the talk. Thank you very much, Bernd. So dear Twitch viewers, this was the last talk for today.